Hi folks, God bless you, hope everybody's okay. Just sharing the gospel today. We're in Manchester and Frank, my brother's come down from Holland and we're in Manchester today. Just to say that we'll be debating some Muslim apologists. I pulled the videos now that I made because I was tired when I made those videos. I was in the evening and I was just a bit tired. And I made a few other videos that I was tired, so I just pulled them down. That's why I pulled them down. They had quite a lot of views. If these Muslim apologists want to debate me, I'm happy to debate them. I don't think they are as scholarly as they pretend to be. I don't think they're as good as they pretend to be, but I'm happy to debate them if they want to debate. But we're just out here to share the gospel, so that's what we're going to do today. So God bless you, and let's get on. Hi folks, we're looking at 2 Timothy chapter 3 and I'm going to pray and ask the Lord's blessing upon his word. This know also in the last days. God bless you. You need Jesus, mate. God bless you. Says in the word of God, this know in the last days perilous times shall come. The men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, without natural affection, truth breakers, false accusers, incontinent, fierce, despisers of those that are good, traitors, any high-minded. Lovers of pleasure.
Tweet
yourself
in before Christmas.
It's a bit windy, guys. Lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God, having a form of godliness, but denying the power thereof, for such turn away. For this sort are they which creep into houses and lead captive silly women, laden with sins, led by their diverse lusts, ever learning, never able to come to the knowledge of the truth. Now as Jans and Jamborees withstood Moses, so do these also resist the truth. Men of corrupt minds, reprobate concerning the faith. They shall proceed no further, for their folly shall be manifest unto all men, as theirs also was. But thou hast fully known my doctrine, manner of life, purpose, faith, long-suffering, charity, patience, persecutions, afflictions, which come unto me at Antioch, Iconium, what persecutions I endured, but out of them all the Lord delivered me. Yea, and all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. But evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. But continue thou in the things which thou hast learned, and has been assured of, knowing of thou hast learned them. And that from a child thou hast known the holy scriptures, which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith, which is in Christ Jesus. All scripture is given by inspiration of God, and is profitable for doctrine, for rebuke, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be thoroughly, fairly furnished in all God works. Says here, all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for rebuke, for correction in all unrighteousness. That the word of God is eternal, that the word of God is all powerful, and the word of God can help you get to heaven. Get to heaven by the word of God. The word of God is your sat-nav. The word of God can help you know how to get to heaven. For in the word of God, it teaches you how to get to heaven. God bless you, bro. The word of God teaches you how to get to heaven. It teaches you about Jesus Christ. In the word of God, it reveals the truth of who Jesus is. Says in the word of God, in 1 Timothy 3:16, great is the mystery of godliness, that Christ, that God was manifest in the flesh. That the word of God tells us how to get to heaven. And if you want to know how to get to heaven, the way to get to heaven is by believing in Jesus Christ the Lord. He is the one that can help you. There is no other one today. The wrath of God is real, and God is a holy God, and He's a fire God, a God of holy fire. And as a God of holy fire, a God who must purify this world with His holiness, He judged. He judged. And the wrath of God came upon Christ. And the wrath of God fell upon Christ. And when Christ died on that cross, the wrath of God fell upon Him. For God is a consuming fire, and He must judge. He must judge, for He is a righteous God. But the judgment fell upon Christ. For Christ suffered the just for the unjust. He suffered on your behalf and gave His life for you on your behalf, and died on your behalf, and shed His blood on your behalf. And you find this in the holy word of God, in the pure holy word of God, the word of God, the mighty word of God, the Bible, the holy Bible, can show you the way to heaven. If you want to go to heaven today, only the word of God, only the Bible can teach you how to get to heaven. Only the Bible can teach you how to get to heaven. No other way. For He is the one that loved you. God bless you, bro.
Are you all right, brother? Yeah?
I'm all right. You okay?
No.
Oh, God. What's up, bro? Come here, give us a hug.
We're fucking persecuted as Christians. We're always in the fucking prison. Do you know what I mean? Yeah?
Oh, well, Christ died for you, mate.
I know, eh? But why are us Christians persecuted? We're always in the fucking prison.
Well, it says here, it says in the last days, you know, if you want to follow Christ, you're going to get persecuted, bro.
People can't see it, man. They can't fucking see it, man. They can't see all the earthquakes and fucking all that shit that's going on.
But Christ died for you, and you know that, don't you, bro?
I love Him, man.
Yeah, yeah.
He's dead. You know what I mean, yeah?
All right, God bless you, man. God bless you.
I'll see you later.
Get close to Jesus, yeah?
Try.
All right. The word of God, the mighty word of God, has the message of heaven for you today. Oh, how do you get to heaven? You get to heaven by knowing Jesus Christ the Lord, by knowing Christ died for you, by knowing Christ loved you, by knowing Christ gave His life for you. But He gave His life for you by dying on that cross, that He loved you and died on that cross because He loved you. Oh, how deep the love of Jesus, how wonderful the love of Christ, how beautiful that Christ would die for you on that cross. There's no other way to be saved. Not Muhammad, not Buddha, not atheism, not Mormonism or Hinduism, but only Christ. Oh, do you want to go to heaven today?
Down.
Do you want to go to heaven today? Do you want to go to heaven today? My friend, do you want to go to heaven today? In the Word of God, all Scripture is breathed of God. And in the last days, there will be deception. In the last days, there will be deception. The Mormons will come. The Buddhists will come. Deception will reign. And deception will come from all flooding the land. Islam will come. Atheism will come. They'll all come and flood the land with heresy and false doctrine and false teaching of men. But the only way to know the way of heaven is by the Bible, by the Holy Bible. God breathed Scripture. God breathed the Scripture that you may know the way to heaven. Not by the reason of men, not by the wisdom of man, but by the Holy Bible, by the Holy Bible of God. That is the only way to heaven. Not by anybody else, but Jesus Christ. Only Him. Only Christ can save you. And only in the Word of God. Only in the Holy Bible. You can't get to heaven by believing in Ed Sheeran. You can't get to heaven by believing in Lady Gaga. You can't get to heaven by smoking wacky backy. You can't get to heaven by taking crack cocaine. You can't get to heaven by looking at porn. The only way you can get to heaven is by believing in Jesus Christ the King. Christ the King. Christ the Lord. Christ the Savior. Christ and only Him. Christ. Christ and only Christ. Only Christ can save you. Not your drugs. Not your wacky-backy. Not your alcohol. Not your materialism, but Christ. He is the Savior who can save you in these last days. Heresy will flood the land. False religion will flood the land. The land will be flooded with evil. And only the Word of God stands in the evil day. Only the Word of God stands in the evil day to help you to see how evil the day is. Politicians will grow more evil. Religion will grow more evil. The media will grow more evil. But the Bible stands pure and true, the rock of Gibraltar in this evil age. The Word of God. The Word of God. Build your family on the Word of God, my friends. Build your family on the Word of God. Not by tradition, not by men's ideas, not by political correctness, but by the Word of God. Build your family on the Word of God. And down with political correctness. Down with political correctness. Be gone with your political correctness. And come with the Word of God in every home, in every family, in every college, in every university, in every politician's room. May the Word of God come. And may political correctness crumble, crumble under the Word of God. Come back to the Word, my friend. Come back to the Word of God before it's too late. Before you wake up and see Christ come on His horse with 10,000s of angels, and the glory of God will come. God bless you, sir. I'm speaking about Jesus, sir. I'm speaking about His love, sir. He loves you, sir, and He gave His life for you, sir. Shed His blood for you, sir. gave his life for you on that cross, bro. Gave his life. I'm preaching about Jesus, sir. Do you know who Jesus is? God bless you, sir. God bless you. Do you know who Jesus is? Eh? God bless you. He loves you, yeah? He loves you, sir. He loves you, sir. God bless you. Yeah, I'm preaching about Jesus, that he loves you, that he gave his life for you, that he died on that cross and gave his life, sir. And he loved you, yeah? Awake and trust him, yeah? Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Jesus loves you, sir. He loves you, bro, yeah? Jesus loves you. He loves you, sir. He loves you, sir. He loves you. Jesus loves you, bro. He loves you, man. He loves you, yeah? He loves you, yeah? He loves you, sir, yeah? He loves you, yeah? He loves you, bro. He loves you, yeah? God bless you. Yeah. He is Lord. He is Lord. He is risen from the dead. And he is Lord. Every knee shall bow. Every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. God bless you, brother. God bless you, sir. God bless you. It's all right, it's all right, it's all right. It's all right. It's okay. Christ loved you. He died for you on that cross. He gave his life for you on that cross. And the word of God can save you. Only believe in the word of God. The word of God can save you, my friend. All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine and for teaching. The word of God is profitable for you today. We're living in a dark age. In the last days, it says it'll be dark. And it's getting darker and darker and darker, my friend. It's getting darker and darker in this world. Men, lovers of themselves. Men, fierce. Men, brutal. Men, God bless you, brother. God bless you. Are you okay?
Hi, Jason.
Are you all right? God bless you.
God bless you.
That's Frank. That's Frank. He's from Holland. Men, lovers of themselves. Men fierce, men loving pleasure rather than God. And here the word of God stands like a mighty oak, and it can never be destroyed by political correctness. No matter how powerful political correctness comes, it will never destroy the word of God in this dark age. That is what you need today. Awake! Awake out of the darkness! Oops. Nice. Oops, a daisy.
Are you up there, Jason?
Hello, bro. It's a windy day.
It's a windy day.
Thanks, bro. Thanks a lot, mate. Thanks a lot. How are you doing? You okay?
Right, yeah,
good to see you, mate. Thanks, bro.
Yeah.
Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, and it is the way of salvation in this book. And it is the way of salvation in this book. A heavenly book, an eternal book, a wonderful book, a glorious book. It is the word of God. God breathed today. And in the midst of heresy, in the midst of darkness. When the world is descending into chaos and the world is descending into darkness, the Word of God is a lamp to our feet, my friend. The Word of God can guide you. The Word of God can show you the way. Oh, read this book and escape hell. Escape the flames of hell while you can. And read this book. Make no mistake about it. The pleasures of this world, the lust of the flesh and the pride of life, the lust of the flesh and the pride of life will take us down into hell. But the Word of God, here is salvation in the Word of God. Here in this Holy Bible is the pure Word of God. God breathed with a message from heaven for you. A message on how to be saved, not by the wisdom of man, but only by the wonderful, wonderful Word of God, all for you today. In the last day, it'll grow worse. There'll be more wars. There'll be more religious wars. More carnage. More darkness in the last days. But in the last days, you got to escape the wrath of God. In the last days, you've got to escape the judgment to come. While you can. Have you ever lied? Have you ever slept around? Have you ever gossiped? Have you ever worshipped a God that is not Jesus? Then, my friends, the Bible says, all fall short of the glory of God. My friends, there is a hell. My friends, do not go to hell. Do not go to hell on your pleasures of this world. Do not go to hell on the pleasures of this world. On the enjoyment of political correctness. For political correctness will damn you to hell. It'll take you down to hell. It'll destroy you. The West is collapsing before your very eyes. God bless you, brother. The West is collapsing before your very eyes. Your economy's collapsing. Your political system's collapsing. Cannot you see that the old age of the West is falling apart? Western civilization is falling apart. It's falling apart with this political correctness, my friend. It's falling apart. It's crumbling before your very eyes. The West is crumbling before your very eyes. It's crumbling before your very eyes and you cannot see it. You cannot see how the West is crumbling. It's crumbling before your very eyes, my friend. Crumbling before your very eyes. And you need to know Jesus. You need to know Christ. Have you got a problem, sir?
Yeah, I don't like extremist preachers, mate.
Oh, you don't like preachers who preach Jesus Christ who loves and died for you on the cross, sir?
Why? Well, in the Bible it says not to do that.
Pardon? Why not, sir?
He's worshiping the true God, the one God. He's worshiping an inanimate object.
What's that?
The Bible.
Yeah.
Yeah, we worship God's word.
Yeah, of course we do.
It was written by Moses, the first written by Moses, the Torah. Inspired from God through the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit inspired him to write those books. So it's the Word of God written by Moses. And then Moses was taken away, and then God raised up another man of God, who told the people about God and his ways. And then he did all that he could, and then his life was taken away. Then God raised up another man, and he spoke as well about the future, about the past. Yeah, another man, yeah. No, it wasn't written by man, it's written by God, it's written by the Holy Spirit. This is what we believe.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Or the Gospels of John in there as well.
But it started at the beginning, and Moses wrote the book of Genesis. It started at the beginning, where Moses wrote the book of Genesis.
You open it up.
That's the thing, I think that happens.
Lift it up.
To everything. God is eternal.
Yeah, that's it. You lift it up. There's tons of stuff in there, Luke. I'm just going to film these guys just a minute.
We can't put that time. I'm not avoiding the question, but you can guess. I say, what, a few million years ago? About 20 million years ago? About 50 million years ago? It doesn't matter when it happened, it actually happened. The earth did begin. God created this earth. You see, God created this earth, yeah? And since that time, and because of what happened in the Garden of Eden, God has wrote the word of the Bible so men would know the truth, and men would know the truth and why what happened happened.
Why?
No, it was written by the Holy Spirit.
You're actually saying
that you don't believe in the spirit world. You don't believe in the spirit world. So
I believe in things that are provable.
So you think you are the flesh, you think you are the body?
I am flesh.
And the body.
I can feel flesh. Quite a bit of body.
But so when I'm looking at you, yeah? Because I can't see you. What I see.
I'm
telling you, brother. What's your name?
Cameron.
I see your face, I see your eyes, I see your nose, I see your mouth, your shoulders, your arms, your legs, your body. But I can't see you, but I do know that you're in that body. You're only in that body, and you're only going to be in that body for 80 odd years, and then that body will give up, but you will not die.
Can you prove it?
Pardon?
I like things that can be proven.
How can that be proven?
Well, it can't.
It can be proven. The Word of God. We have the Word of God that can prove it.
That's a very circular line of argument, really.
Well, in the Word of God.
Can you prove it?
The Word of God.
Listen. That doesn't really work. That's the most circular argument in the world.
Listen. A little child.
Yeah.
Yeah. And his parents say, "Come over here, son.
Yeah.
I've got some sweets from Toffees for you." The son runs over to his dad, yeah? Runs over to his dad because he believes his dad, he trusts his dad, and he believes his dad. His dad's not going to bring him no harm, he believes. So to accept the story of the Bible, you have to be like a little child. You have to have. He's not going to do that because he loves you. How could he do any harm?
It did
call a lot of children. Where's it?
That's in the Old Testament.
Where?
Old Testament.
Go on.
They called one of the
Elijah.
Elijah, mate? I don't know.
Elijah.
It's been a while. Called him Baldy.
Don't mess with the man of God. That's what it is, bro, isn't it?
But he says he's not going to harm anyone. You're saying, good on him, he killed him.
Yeah, where was that?
Where was it?
Yeah, what passage was it?
I believe Old Testament.
Fantastic. Yeah. At least you know the Old Testament.
Yeah. So our advice is that
you get that Bible and read it and try and disprove it.
I've read it quite a few times.
So. Well, keep reading and try and disprove it.
I can do it quite a few. There's a lot of times where it contradicts itself.
It doesn't contradict itself.
Can I just ask a question?
Yeah.
Yeah. Come in, mate. Are you open-minded?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm not open-minded that my brain's going to fall out.
Yeah. No. Less of the rhetoric. Are you open-minded?
Yeah.
So, have you investigated Christianity?
Yes.
So,
just like I've investigated Islam and Judaism.
So, you've investigated about the life of Christ?
Yes.
So, what main scholarly work have you read about the life of Christ?
Oh, take your pick, mate. I can't reel out who I've read.
Just name me one.
Take a bit. I can pull them up on my phone if you really want.
Just name me one. Yeah, go for it.
Name me one. Contradictions in the Bible.
No. I asked a specific question, Cameron. I said to you, bro, are you open-minded?
Yes.
What have you read about Jesus Christ?
I could reel out the
not internet
candidates.
Atheism, where you just try internet to pull up a few quotes.
No, this isn't quotes,
know,
mate.
I'm on about scholarly works.
Well, I could go for the obvious ones. Anything by Dawkins.
Yeah. So you regard Dawkins as a scholarly work on the life of Jesus?
I think he's got some pretty decent points.
So have you read God
religion?
Delusion?
No, actually, that's one I haven't. But I'm going to avoid that one.
Well,
because I know a lot of people that do believe.
Cameron,
have
read
I've
that read one. That, bro. So,
yep.
So Cameron, what we've established, right?
Yeah.
You haven't read, you know, with all due respect, you haven't read any main scholarly work about the life of Christ, such as?
I haven't got a list of references.
Dawkins isn't a scholarly guy about the life of Christ.
I don't have references on me right now. I accept Jesus was a man. Do I accept he's the Son of God?
Let me give you a 101. If you read Dawkins' God Delusion, you read Christopher Hitchens' God Is Not Great, and Sam Harris's The End of Faith. These are works that I've read, bro, yeah?
Yeah. You've already admitted that God does not.
Yeah, but bro, listen.
Yeah?
They're not in any way in touch with historical Jesus studies, bro. They're a joke.
There's improved.
No, but they make comments in those books about the historical Jesus. They're just not in touch with this book. But you said you're open-minded.
Yeah.
But if you just think about it, if you're open-minded, your main best arguers like Dawkins and people like that,
the main best arguer is reading the Bible itself.
They're not in touch with basic scholarship.
Yeah, no, but I've read the Bible. That's my main point.
But have you ever lied?
Have I ever what?
Have you ever lied?
Lied? Everyone has lied.
Well, when Christ died on that cross, he died for your lies, bro. Gave his life for you. He died on your behalf.
Plenty of people died on the cross.
No, but he died as the Son of God. He said, I give my life a ransom for many.
He was a man.
And he shed his blood for you. He gave his life for you.
He's a beautiful man.
Would you say throwing tables around a temple?
The temple at that time was meant to be a house of prayer, a house of God, a house of prayer. Jesus was only upset because they were using this temple. They had stalls in there, and they were selling doves, and they were selling calves for sacrifice, and they were making money. They weren't interested in God himself. They just used the premises to do their wares and things. So Jesus was angry at that, and he drove them out the temple.
Did he not say turn the other cheek?
What do you mean turn the other cheek? Turn the other cheek when someone insults you, someone harms you.
They were insulting his temple, he couldn't turn the other cheek.
No, it's a different. They were turning it into idolatry,
yes,
which is different. They were worshipping money rather than God. They weren't helping the poor. Cameron, they weren't helping the poor. Like they should have been. It was more about money. Here's a question.
Are you helping the poor right now?
Here's a question. My friend,
there were two guys over there that were very poor.
That's ad hominem.
Our church comes out in the evening.
And our guys.
And we have a food bank and we have a clothing thing.
My issue is I don't like people going out shouting at people for their life choices, which is what you were doing.
But you made a choice to stand.
He's preaching the word of God.
You made a choice, bro.
I made a choice to what?
You made the choice to stand. You did not have to stand and talk to us.
I didn't start talking to you. You started talking to me.
Yeah, but you made the choice to engage with me.
No, I didn't. I was standing here.
You come and stood in front of him and you kept blocking him.
I'm waiting for my
mates. Yeah, but every time he moved to one side, you moved to that side.
You kept blocking me, bro.
You tried to block him. No. You knew what you were doing and I stood there and watched you.
That's just internet atheism, mate.
Oh, you can throw out internet atheism all you like.
They're not very scholarly today.
If the Bible says something that contradicts each other, would you accept that?
It doesn't contradict itself, mate. I mean, what website is that? Is that atheist.com?
Dodging the Bible.com. Yeah.
There's more contradictions in Dawkins' books than that, mate.
If you were up for a decent debate, I'd go for it.
Yeah, but you're doing
atheist.com.
Yeah, but you're the ones doing the ad hominem, not us, bro.
Oh, I've not attacked you.
It's not attacked me, have you?
You attacked people here saying, oh, you chose to do this, you chose to do that.
How can you?
That's an ad hominem attack. You're attacking them for their life choices.
You don't believe in the spirit, you don't believe that you're a spiritual being,
I don't believe in people shouting at people for their life choices.
But I want you to understand that you are a spiritual man in a body.
What gets me with these?
And
God created you, made you, loves you. Look at you, you're his creature, his creation. And you're unique, there's no one like you on the planet.
Yes, there is.
No, there ain't.
Genetically, there probably is.
No, there ain't. Your fingerprint, there's no one with your fingerprint. There's no one with your...
You know it's true, anyway.
You are uniquely
amazing.
Hello. Hello.
Jason, what can we do? Seeds, innit? Just drop the seeds.
Outside Halifax. I'm waiting, still waiting on the corner by Halifax.
He's with some Jesus freaks.
There's
just some Jesus love.
Listen to the fella that's shouting at people for what they choose to do in life.
Oh, we love God!
Hey, what gets me, Cameron, is you modern people are supposed to be tolerant. And you're intolerant.
I'm not tolerant, I'm intolerant.
No, you're intolerant.
I don't tolerate intolerance.
I never stop anyone free speech. You do. You were standing in front of me stopping me, bro. I don't do that. No, Cameron, I've never stopped anyone having their free speech. You have, bro. Because you were stood in front of me.
You could still
and you were moving. Nah, come on, mate.
Me standing is not stopping you.
It's a double standard. Total intolerance, mate.
Hate speech should not be tolerated.
Have you ever stood in front of a gay pride march? Have you ever stood in front of the Muslims?
If they were doing hate speech,
it's not hate speech talking about Jesus Christ.
No, saying you are going to have your
right. Is there such thing as right and wrong? Is there such thing as right and wrong?
Yes, what you are doing is wrong.
How do you know what is right? How do you know what is wrong?
Potentially, someone being a dick to other people.
No, how do you know what is right and how do you know what is wrong? You don't know, you see. You're anti-intellectual. And you're narrow-minded. You're narrow-minded, bro. And you're intolerant. And you're pushing your subjectivity of narrow-mindedness on me, bro.
But aren't you pushing your
opinion onto because if you stand here week in, week out, loads of people come here and we debate and we discuss. We have rational debate and discuss.
Your level of debate is atheist.com.
Because you were being fair, you were doing a lot of ad hominems.
I did no ad hominems.
You did.
Name one ad hominem.
You did lots of ad hominems.
Which one?
You attacked me about saying we don't help the homeless, you should help the homeless. That's ad hominem. Wait a minute. You're not here every week. Wait a minute.
No.
We have loads of people on our team that help homeless people. I help homeless people.
And if you go,
if you go around and talk to the homeless people, they think a lot about us and me. Because we help them.
But so you're ad hominem. I'm sure they don't appreciate the time that you're shouting.
Actually, a lot of people come up to me and thank me at the home.
For shouting.
For preaching, yeah.
And saying, oh, you're going to hell for what you've done in your life.
Why don't you believe, bro?
Why don't I believe in what?
Because you know it's true.
Well, I know what's true.
Jesus is true.
I've seen zero evidence.
There's loads of evidence.
I've seen evidence of Jesus being a man. He was a man, he existed, he lived, he died. I do not have any evidence.
You believe he died for you on that cross?
No, I don't. I believe he died probably due to societal pressures at the time.
So, let's go with you. Are you an atheist or an agnostic?
I probably would refer to myself as neither.
So what are you?
I like to judge what's put in front of me. What's been put in front of me.
So what you've displayed there is
zero evidence.
Complete intellectual dishonesty. Complete intellectual dishonesty. Total dishonesty.
If someone came up to me,
how can you have a rational debate and discussion when you're not willing to disclose your position?
I disclosed it and said,
you did not disclose
evidence in front of me that God existed. Outright.
Are you an agnostic or an atheist?
If someone came up to me,
are you an agnostic or an atheist? Be intellectually honest.
You're almost as atheistic as I just believe in one less God than you.
Okay,
answer me one question.
Well, I've asked you the question.
Okay, I would say I'm an agnostic atheist.
But why did you say that in the first place?
Because I was trying to give you a better answer than you
no,
were.
No,
you
right,
wanted I've a debate, single word.
No, I've debated hundreds of people. When the people like you...
Okay.
No, wait a minute. When people like you do that, it's because they don't want to be honest about the position, because they don't want it to be critiqued.
I'm more than happy to give you my position, but I just didn't want to use that label.
Because I've pushed you to give you that.
No, but I didn't want to use that label. I wanted to say to you, at the minute I've had no evidence of a God existing, so that's my position. If someone came up to me and said, here is concrete, irrefutable evidence that God exists, I'd say, okay, back up, theistic, all the rest of my life, you show me, God exists.
So you're an agnostic atheist?
Yeah.
Okay. And what would that be? What's that position?
That's the position that I just outlined there.
Right, okay.
Okay, here's
my question. You can't see clearly at all. The air you breathe is pitch black.
Odin,
the biblical God. The biblical God.
Which one? There's many Bibles which are holy books.
Oh, can you see? You think you see? Well, you're in darkness. You're walking in darkness. Living in darkness.
Which one? No, this is me. You can't avoid the question.
Right, I'm going to put the camera on me, right? Can you ask me the question, what you just asked me then?
When you refer to the Son of God, which God are you referring to?
I'm on about the God of the Holy Bible, the Word of God here, the Bible. Yeah,
so that's one of the gods in the world. There are many gods that are believed in. Yeah. Why do you think that yours is the right one?
Because of two reasons, right? Presuppositions. No. Two reasons. Presuppositions and evidences. Right?
What evidence?
Right. No. Before you get to evidence, you've got to look at presuppositions.
Okay.
Everybody has presuppositions they can't prove. You have presuppositions you can't prove. You can't prove reality is real.
No.
So that's a presupposition that reality is real. Yeah? Right? My presupposition is that God's made this. No, just listen, because I'm being fair to you, yeah? You ask me a question, I'm answering it in an honest way, yeah? My presupposition that God created this universe so that I can engage in reality. If that wasn't the case, I couldn't engage, I wouldn't know this was reality. Right? Your presupposition is, it could be an alien's messing with your brain to see if this is reality or not. You don't know. Could be your brain's in a vat. No, I'm not saying it is. I'm just saying there are possibilities. So my presupposition makes more sense, I think. Secondly, there is evidence about Jesus dying and rising again. Right?
Is it in there?
No, there's evidence in there and outside. Right? Evidence that he died on the cross is outside the Bible as well as inside the Bible. You've got evidence. Josephus and Tacitus say that he died on the Pontius Pilate. Right? So that's when we know. Secondly, we know Christ died on the cross, and then secondly, we know about the empty tomb. There was an empty tomb.
That just means the body's missing.
Yeah, no, I give you that. But the point is, which is the best explanation for that?
Probably either someone looted the tomb or an animal took the body and ate it.
So the soldiers, if they allowed it to be looted, they would have been executed.
Sure, the soldiers wouldn't have done much against.
We don't have any record of that.
Again, this is a very long time ago, mate. Record keeping isn't exactly up to modern standards.
Okay.
As we know by the contradictions
but
in the
how
Bible.
Do you know, how do we attest evidence in history? If you look at Dawkins, I know that's what I'm saying. If you look at Dawkins on the historical Jesus in his God Delusion, Sam Harris in his End of Faith, and Hitchens on God Is Not Great, they don't really know about how to verify things
Jesus
in history.
Is the light of the world.
There's a very well accepted way.
Jesus. Okay, how?
I'll tell you a bit, mate. Look at primary sources, secondary sources.
Right, now we're talking. So
there are very few primary sources from that time.
Okay, but there are certain ways that we can know things, and by the basic secular way of looking at history, we can find certain facts about Jesus. That he died, there was an empty tomb, and that, whether you agree with it or not, the disciples preached that he rose again. Whether you agree with it happening.
Yeah, people can preach all
so,
they want.
So those three facts, historical facts.
First two, yes, third one.
I'm glad you're engaging. You're engaging with me, though. You are engaging with me in a fair way.
At that point, the third point becomes opinion.
But the point
can easily be moulded.
But the point, what I'm saying is, now we're engaging. Now we're being respectful. No, there's been a bit of jousting going on between us. But what I'm saying is, you don't have to be saying I'm intolerant when I'm trying to have a rational discussion with you.
If you're shouting at people saying, oh, you're doing this, you're looking at porn, you're going to hell for that, that's not fair on people, man.
Did I say your name?
Not my name, but you said man.
Did I point to you?
No, you said man as a whole, but I class myself as a
did I point to you?
No.
Right. Did I say you?
No.
Your name, right.
No.
It is right, wait a minute, it's legitimate to preach in the public and state your case. So long as I don't pick an individual, call out their name, then that I am judging that specific person. It's not wrong to say, this is what the Bible says. Wait a minute, Cameron. Lying's wrong, repent. Immorality is wrong. Sexual immorality is wrong, repent. It's not wrong.
Hang on, who gets to decide what's sexually immoral or not?
God's word.
Whoa, God does not mention a lot of things in the world.
The Bible, bro.
God does not mention a lot of things about sex in there.
Well, don't commit adultery, bro.
He rules!
That's just one thing.
Well, that's
there are a lot of things that get preached.
Yeah.
There are lots of things that get preached that are not mentioned in there.
I'm not allowed to preach anything unless it's in that Bible, bro.
There's a lot of stuff that does get preached from that book that isn't in that book.
I'm not allowed to preach anything unless it's in the book, bro.
Well, what about gay marriage?
It's in the book, it says it's wrong.
No, it doesn't. Where does it say gay marriage is wrong?
Read Romans chapter 1.
Well, what does it say?
In Romans chapter 1, it says gay sex and lesbian sex is wrong in Romans chapter 1.
It doesn't say gay marriage.
That covers it, bro.
No, it doesn't. It. No, it doesn't. That just means you can't have sex.
Wait a minute. Jesus
have sex.
Is the authority, right?
Yeah.
And his authority clearly states that he believed that the Old Testament is the Word of God.
Well, okay, in that.
Wait a minute. He clearly states the Old Testament is the Word of God. When God gave the Ten Commandments, you're saying that when he gave those Ten Commandments about only marriage, that within that context, it was gay marriage?
It could have been. He didn't say.
Come on.
Plenty of cultures have had gay sex over the years.
Yeah. Was gay marriage in the Old Testament?
Was straight marriage? There was no mention specifically of
was gay
man
marriage.
Must marry was, a woman, was woman gay, must
well,
marry a man.
Well, there was. Adam and Eve was the first marriage. Yeah. Of course they were.
By who?
Jesus says it. Actually, he says just as it's with Adam and Eve, that's how marriage should have been in the first place because there was. Because,
I would love to see that worded.
Because then
it should have been like that in the first place.
Because there was polygamy in the time of Jesus, and there was arguments about. There was arguments about who married who when you died. Are you still married? And Jesus specifically referred to the Old Testament, the Genesis account about marriage.
If you can show me in black and white in there where it says gay marriage is wrong, I'll accept your argument, but you can't.
The Ten Commandments.
Which one?
Let's read the Ten Commandments.
I would love to know which one says gay marriage is wrong. Again, thou shalt not kill. That's a good
one. Wait. Thou shalt not commit adultery.
Gay marriage, adultery.
Well, it is adultery.
Well, how? Jason, I feel for you, man. Because people just.
I know, don't worry. I keep doing it, mate. Don't
you have to.
Because I love them, mate.
Yeah, man.
I love them, mate.
Apart from gay people. Let's put that caveat on.
No, that is terrible. That is terrible.
You just said they can't get married.
Because it says it here, Ten Commandments, thou shalt not commit adultery.
If they love each other, why can't they get
married? Can you have love with truth without truth?
Yeah.
No, you can't.
Why is it not true?
Have you ever seen?
You can't have love without truth.
I'm officiating over a lesbian wedding.
Yeah. What?
Yeah.
Have you ever?
It's not according to the Bible.
Have you ever?
They wouldn't want it.
Have you ever seen two female singles, two female birds having it up with each other?
Okay. Please tell me you're arguing there's no gayness.
Just remember, we're sticking on. Because we could get arrested with it. Romans chapter 1. We're standing. Are you?
God's word. There is a God.
Bro.
And he did say something.
Bro, there is a God. Bro, we're standing on Romans 1, aren't we? Romans chapter 1, yeah.
I can go buy you the book.
Go on, read Romans 1.
Hedgehogs, dolphins, plenty of animals have gay sex. Lions have gay sex.
Read to read Romans, read to the Bible. You need to read the Bible.
I've read the Bible.
The word of God.
I have read the word of men.
What God says about all of this.
That was men that wrote it.
No, God wrote it.
Men that wrote it.
God wrote it. God wrote it.